soon after our phenomenal historic victory in 2018. Now, the euphoria was such that people expect us to effect change, to honor our commitment, to be the beacon of hope, dealing with issues of poverty, inequality, institutional reform, anti-corruption drive. I must concede that to an extent, we were successful. But as always, there were flaws. We did renege on our commitments, and we tend to sometimes be rather conflicting in our views in terms of whether to continue to reject the race card and the religious bigotry, or to continue to suggest that Malaysia must remain and be entrapped by the old thinking of the old regime that race should be a factor, and in any struggle you talk about multiracial liberal society is deemed to be irrelevant. We had to pay a heavy price because of this complicity and contradiction. So you have to learn from these experiences. You must not be unnecessarily tied to the thinking which is clearly obsolete, condoning any form of corruption or racism, and therefore we need to move as confidently as a new force in this country. Well, we did succeed, as I said, for example, in exposing the crimes of one MDB. Yeah. But corruption does not end there. It actually reflects the fragility of the system, the failure of the enforcement agencies, political leadership, media, and also judicial issue of judicial independence. Now, if you want to, for example, change that direction or deal with the issue of 1MDB, then we have to look at the entire system. So we require systemic change. Now, you deal today mainly on the issue of unity. And I think no one should question the need to work, realize the ideals of our fathers and mothers of independence, where they talk about bersekutu bertambah mutu, or in Indonesia, bineka tunggal ika, or the United States, il pluribus unum, or centering the direction, the need to be united. But the next question that the young generation should ask, unite for what? After all, if you recall, your parents would know this about the story of Alibaba, Mujang Lapuk with the 40 penyamun. They are also united. P. Ramlee probably wanted to realize that unity must be for a good cause, not unity among robbers. And in fact, it is Quranic. It will refer one of the basic ayah that has been popularized is in the Quran, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. I mean, the call to be united. But it's predicated upon the term بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ, the rope of Allah, which talks about faith, about justice, about compassion, about humanity. Now, you can't say, for example, let us all be united. Malays must unite. Otherwise, we are being threatened by the non-Malays. Or the Chinese, or the Indians, or the Dayaks. Now, Dayakism. To survive, we all must be united. But for what purpose? To defend your rights, justice, compassion? Yes. But if the issue is justice and compassion and right, then it must transcend tribes. It must transcend provincialism or tribalism. You must transcend race, because the ultimate objective is to effect change, to implement, to ensure that there's justice, virtue, and compassion. Of course, this is a philosophical framework that we must understand. Otherwise, everybody talks about bersatu bertambah maju, unity is strength, or bineka tunggal ika. But nobody questioned, why is there this clear and call for unity? During the pre-independence period, we understand, of course, that is meant for essentially to appeal to the masses to be united in their struggle against colonialism and imperialism. Right? You know you are united to reject something. Like one at the A time, Pakatan Harapan was united to reject Barisan Nasional, which to us represents an obsolete, corrupt order. But the next question is whether the unity is only to reject or to effect change and implement meaningful reform. This is the challenge that you must continue to engage, discuss in a more reasoned discourse what is meant by change and reform, and why is there a necessity to undertake meaningful reform.